Kia ora everyone. So if you haven't met me before, I'm Charmaine Bailie. I have had a lot to say about plants and nurseries in the Auckland region. So yeah, it was me saying to Janet, Janet, we need to do something about this. And Janet actually with Jane making it happen. So we put together a program and we needed to name the program something. And so this is the something. The something is Iwi Hapu Community Nurseries Network. Bit of a mouthful because there's actually a lot more to it than that. We haven't also put in the title about private backyards, schools, and everybody else. The only unifying factor about the Iwi Hapu Community Nursery Network with backyards and schools is that none of them make a profit. That's about the only thing actually they have in common, other than very, very passionate about growing plants. So yeah, so this happened 3 years ago, but it was probably after about 7 years of wanting it to happen. How do we get people together and share knowledge, break the myth about they're competing with each other? Nurseries in this space don't compete with each other. There might be a thing about funding or procurement or contracts, but actually it's just not true. We hardly hold funding, procurement or contracts, so we don't compete really in that way. And what we have is the connection and love and passion. I'm sure you're all plant lovers, and you know that if you put three people that love a plant in the same space, they can talk for a very long time. This is very true of nursery volunteers and managers. So, let's see what the next slide is about. I just wanted to thank you, Jane. Thank the Auckland Council for making it actually possible. Thank Kaipāraki Project, Janet and the whole team, Derek and everyone that inspired this program to keep going. So they keep the drive, they keep the focus, and I just have the privilege of facilitating it. I get to go and see everybody and meet people. So what do we have? A lot of nurseries. So the top right is Kaipāraki Project, and it's been going for 20 years now. Is it my top right, your top left? Sorry, it's the left. You can work that one out, right? So it's the new nursery. The new nursery has been evolving for a few years now. Kaipāraki, when I first walked down the driveway 20 years ago, needed some help with the two nurseries they had at schools. So Kaipāraki has always been about a central nursery and going out and having satellite nurseries. It was in schools then, and it's in Hobsonville now. So that's one kind of nursery. The one on the other side, on the right, is the nursery up at Te Arai. So that's in the far north, and that's an iwi-based nursery. They have no volunteers. They only have staff. So Kaipāraki grows something like 40,000. Te Arai grows something like 800,000. Quite different nurseries, different space, different type. The one on the left grows something like 108 species. The one on the right grows something like about 25 species at the moment. So there's quite a diverse range. And one of the unifying factors about all nurseries, the other thing is looking for seed and seed banking. So talk a bit more about that in a minute. Where are they all? So at the moment there's 41 identified nurseries. And it's not the greatest map to look at, but you can see that most of them are in the Tāmaki region at the moment. The biggest nursery is the one at number two, up in the far north, I said Te Arai, that we were talking about before, and all the way down to the entire range of the Auckland region is covered by nurseries. What we don't have is an entire range of nursery species covering that area. So there's 41 different types. Some of the sizes, as I said, are anywhere between 500 plants a year to 800,000. New nurseries, and I say new because Ōrākei has been going for 16 years now but has a new nursery site. It's gone from a capacity of having 40,000 plants up to now has a capacity for 300,000 plants and can grow up to 500,000 plants. So that's new in the sense of the expansion. So there's a vast range of sizes and types. As I said, there's schools, iwi, hapu, backyard nurseries. Some of our backyard nurseries are people that don't even recognise how special and important they are. They say things like, oh, we've just been growing 3,000 to 5,000 plants down our driveway after work. We don't even have a nursery name. It's just something I do down my driveway. It turns out that they've been doing that down their driveway for the last 10, 15 years. You do the maths on 5,000 times even 10 years. They've been contributing over 50,000 plants into the Auckland Public Reserves, just down their driveway after work, paying for their own potting mix. They have no structure. So they're not a charity, they're not a social enterprise, they're not a not-for-profit, they just have no money to even have no profit, and they do it all off their own back. So that's kind of the scale and scope of nurseries across the region. Very few have staff. As you can see on the bottom of the screen, only 3 of those 41 nurseries actually have full-time staff. There's some with part-time staff. There's some with volunteers. Some of the volunteer nurseries only gather one day a week for 3 hours. Some gather twice a week. And some just ring each other when they're going to go, because there's so few of them now, they don't even have a set day. But they're still producing quite a lot of plants. So the scope in which you have support, human support for growing those plants, is quite variable between sites as well. Selling plants or not selling plants, we've only got 6 nurseries right now that actually sell plants, actively say you can buy a plant off us. Still being reminded they're not making a profit, they're just trying to offset their part-time staff or some of the potting mix bill. We have, which means, you know, you can do the maths between 41 and 6. That means there's a lot of purpose-grown plants for projects. So the other thing that's leading the production schedules in nurseries are what the project needs or what funding is available to be spent before June that we could grow get some plants to put into a project, to put into reserve before time period ends. So what isn't happening a lot in those 41 nurseries is pre-planning far enough out to let a manager know what they need to plant, what they need to collect, what they need to secure in order to have a production schedule that's specific to the project they're specifically growing for. So at the moment, that's one of the identified gaps. Part of my work is to go out and visit people, and this is my favourite part, actually. So in the first years, what we used to do is say, when is your planting day, or when is your potting up day, when is your working bee, and we'll come and chat over the potting tables. It's so much better than trying to take a really busy volunteer or nursery manager's time to sit down for another meeting to discuss another topic, to get some more information out of them, to contribute to something that they couldn't see the immediate result of. So he said, well, you know, you're busy, let's just do it over the potting table. And that was really great. And then that was really hard. The next year with COVID, the potting times and working bees and everything else changed. So what we've done this year is we've taken one nursery with us to go and visit the other nursery. So it's not just my joy now. So for the one when we went to Orake, Kaipariki Project came to Orake. Orake came to the Devonport nursery when we visited there. Tōtara, which is an upper Waiwera, came to visit for another nursery. And so we're now just, instead of just talking over the potting tables, taking one nursery, a lot of staff, to the other nursery as we go. And then they can just do the direct connection, which is hugely what the purpose of this project is about. When we go and visit, what are we looking at? What their issues are, what their challenges are, and hearing firsthand from volunteers that don't necessarily get out. The only time you're going to see them is actually at the nursery. They might not make the hui, they might not make the workshop, they might not make presentations like this. It's the only time that we can get to talk to them. And some of those volunteers, of course, like lots of people in this room who've been working in this area or for the last couple of decades. So they've got a lot of knowledge about what's happening in their nursery, where they get their seeds from, what their biggest challenges are, and how they've changed over time. So nursery visits are really, really valuable. We had a grandiose plan in year three that we would send out a nursery survey, and I tortured quite a few people with that. It was quite a long survey, I was told. It wasn't supposed to be, I apologise. But it was really valuable because it was all about valuable for us, and we will be sharing it. It was definitely about, you know, is eco-sourcing important? What are your issues around volunteers? What are great about volunteers? Tell us your stories. What are your aspirations? You know, all of those challenges, infrastructure. It's quite a long survey. It was in two different parts. The first part really was centred on those that are trying to keep their own sustainability up through selling plants, and the second was just purely for the love of. So we just wanted to know how we could better support them, who wanted to grow threatened species. Part of the grandiose plan of sending out the survey was finding out what everyone's growing, because hugely the purpose of this network is to see who is growing what where. What are the missing gaps? What else do we need to grow? In my work with another hat as a restoration ecologist, I see a lot, and working as a technical specialist for Mana Whenua, I see a lot of plans that don't have a lot of diversity in them anymore. The diversity is dropping in plans because nurseries aren't growing those plants. Nurseries aren't growing those plants because they can't afford for them to just grow and sit on the shelf, so they're not having enough lead-in time. So one's not growing it, one's not putting it on a plan. One doesn't grow it because it's not on a plan, it's not on a plan because no one's growing it, and it's just going spiraling down in the diversity across the region because of this. At the same time, we have nursery, commercial nurseries that are upscaling and diversifying and becoming more efficient, sustainable, and production efficient, so they're growing less diversity because it's affordable to mass factory produce a smaller range of species. Growing special things can be expensive, doesn't need to be, but that's the way it's seen at present. And so you have a commercial market that's growing less diversity to stay in business. They just need to stay in business. Beautiful, long-term, family-operated commercial nurseries out there that have been doing their best for the environment, their staff, their training, and all of those aspects for the last 20-plus years, they can't afford to grow huge ranges of plants. The other thing that we have and that we've discovered as well is that even some of the not-for-profit and the iwi-based nurseries, as well as the commercial, all sending all of their seed to the same propagator. And the propagator, like I said the other day as well, and when we had this nursery hui, they're very good at their job. They're a great nursery. They've been in business a long time. They're very efficient. They're good prices, great biosecurity, excellent training. There's nothing wrong with that nursery. But the challenge is they can only grow a certain range of size of seed. And so if we have a lot of our large-scale nurseries, both commercial and not-for-profit, sending all their eggs to the same basket, we are also reducing the biodiversity available for planting in our ecosystems, in our restoration projects. So part of this project was who is growing what and where, and then understanding what more we need to grow to get our lists and our biodiversity selection and restoration back where it, you know, the potential of what it could be. That was harder than filling out the survey. Do you think that anyone would send me a list? I think out of the 41 nurseries we have at present, about 6 lists and about 10 that will be coming from notebooks. Another unifying factor across this industry is that seed collection, record keeping, nursery production is kept in notebooks. And maybe we need to make it a part of the funding criteria, because if you're funding and you're looking after volunteer hours, volunteer days, attendees and outcomes around teaching, then you need to record it. But if you just have how many plants you're growing or what type you're growing, somehow that's just in the notebook of the head propagator. So that's one of my biggest challenges in the next little while, is getting actual lists into a database that is compatible and sending it to Jane. Because there will always be a question of, oh, who manages the database, right, of all of our plants. So visits and surveys, yeah. The other part of the work is new nursery support. So there's actually a lot of new nurseries. That's really, really inspiring at the moment. There's a lot of work, especially with the Kaipara Moana remediation for the lower part of the Kaipara region. It's across the whole region, but for in terms of the Auckland region, they're looking at more satellite supportive nursery, marae based, connected to kaitiaki team education hubs. So the nurseries won't be alone, they'll be connected. Those nurseries will be connected also with existing nurseries. There's no nursery left behind in this program. And recognising that they're all different sizes, different people, different plants, and have different needs. But how do we connect what we know together to support that difference instead of making everyone the same? So yes, aspirations and challenges. Aspirations, everyone wants to grow more. Everyone wants to try a different thing, as in more species. Everyone wants to stabilise their sustainability. Everybody wanted to have help with volunteers in terms of educating new volunteers coming in and how those volunteers can be retained. If you have volunteers turn up at a planting day, you can teach them how to plant. And if you have a large group and they go home, that's kind of okay, actually. But if you have a large group turn up at a nursery and you've got to teach them how to pot up to a certain standard and quality and look after a very baby seedling and get it to the next phase, there's actually so many parts of the process to have a really good quality plant, the best health for that plant, whether it's the harvesting, the processing, the seed sowing, the pricking out, the planting, the weeding, the watering, the, you know, in all of those components of a nursery, that you need to retain nursery volunteers and grow that knowledge within the volunteers. And they don't all want to pot up. They don't all want to weed. We're at Kaipāraki Project, we have people that dislike potting around the table. And for physical reasons, they don't want to do the other aspects. And that's fine. There's so many different ranges of skills. So it means that there's so many different components that we need to teach and keep the quality together. So retaining that knowledge and the volunteers is really a key aspect of the well-being of nurseries. Seeds, again, it's just a universal question. I probably get an email every week, if not every other week. Do you know where this tree is? Do you know where these seeds are? And that was exacerbated with COVID, drought before COVID, and new nurseries and funding systems. So the way to go to the last one, because everyone understands COVID and the drought. Funding systems is when a new project comes on board, like a Billion Trees project, and I use Mōtu Tapu, and I'm able to do that. They're fine with that. And the Naitai project for restoring their treaty redress property on Mōtu Tapu. So they, with the milestone agreement, you had to set up by a certain time. You needed to secure X amount of plants by milestones in the first year. You know, you need a nursery to do that. You need to have good relationships with other people around you. You need to do all of these things to make growing trees possible. But if you don't have a seed, you don't have a project. So it was very much a matter of 2 months out of COVID, just out of the previous drought season, and no one had seed banked. We were calling banked, but you know, we'll talk about the wording later. Seed banked any seed for the inner Gulf Islands. So everything had to change. And the whole program ended up being driven about funding milestones and timeframes and what it needed to do. It's not the only one. There's at least, I can name five other nurseries that were impacted because of billion trees, COVID, and seed banking and the lack of, because of that. You know, nursery people just want to get on and grow plants, right? So that was one of the challenges, and it's still a challenge. And we had a hui last weekend, and that was one of the first things that came up again. Seeds, 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 where are all the seeds? The other thing is, if you can't get hold of the commonest things, and you're talking about in your ecological district and in your ecosystem type that's closest to you for your project, because it's a local project, because there's just no one selling outside the area. Okay, so it's very reduced range per thing. You're certainly looking for rarer species or other hard to find, or you know, ferns don't have seeds. So if you're looking at pata for the kaipara, one of the findings that came out of the work with nurseries and the kaipara is that no one's growing pata for the kaipara, which is one of the rarest ferns we have. Is that right, Bex? Is it still the rarest fern, or is it pretty up there? It's pretty up there. It's pretty important fern. So again, they wanted more training, more workshops, more visits. There's a bit of a thing that we have, and it's like, oh, field trip. That's the same for nurseries. All nursery staff want to go on a field trip. They're starting to want to go further and further away now. So workshops is a key part of this network. And in the first year, it was about putting out a notice and who was interested in nurseries and come join us at Kaipatik if you're interested in seed collection or propagation, if you're interested in potting on systems or infrastructure, if you're interested in this and this. And we had a whole menu of workshops that you could sign up for, do one, do them all, and in different places. And that was great. But then last year, running workshops, as you know, would have been a nightmare for anybody because you're just switching and cancelling dates all the time. And in our visits, what we found was with all the new nurseries, they all wanted a different thing. It was actually hard to get a whole lot of people at one nursery on one nursery workshop on one specific topic when 20 people wanted a different thing. So we went, well, that's fine, what do you want? And we tailor the workshops to what the nurseries need now. So, and some of them are really long-term established nurseries, but they have new staff. So in the bottom right-hand corner is Alex Swan, who is the new nursery manager out on Motutapu. For him, he has long experience in nurseries, but not in the Inner Gulf Islands. So his learning curve was, where is everything? You know, who do I talk to? Where do I go to? Who do I network with? He needed just as much help in the connection with people around plants and finding the plants themselves, but not in the technique of what to do with them next. So we have all different levels. Waitotara in the top right corner, they've got a new nursery. It's growing 5,000 plants this year. It's on a private property, but it's open to all of the public, and its core purpose is the restoration of the Waiwera Valley. So that's very location-based, and for them it was the production schedule. They know what the plants are, and they actually knew when some of the seeds for the plants that they needed to grow for the landowners in that area, but they wanted to know the timing. They couldn't afford to waste any space growing too much of any one thing. It's a very limited area. And so production timing was everything for them to get the most efficient efficient production schedule, and also to be able to pass that on to their volunteers. So they're a nursery that are only open for volunteers one morning a week. Yeah, growing 5,000 plants. Now, the other workshop was a bit different this year. So one of the projects that is happening is in the downtown project. We convinced people, the powers that be, that putting epiphytes up trees in coastal areas is natural, and it is. So we are getting epiphytes up trees this year in downtown any day now. But that means that the nursery, and the advantage of epiphytes is that you don't put them in plastic bags, right? You don't have to put them in pots. You don't pop them on. You translocate. You have to do that sustainably. There's a set way of doing that. So it's a clean and best practice. You've got to know where they're coming from and where they're going to. So that workshop was an in-situ nursery workshop, when you're looking at the habitat, the type of plant you're going to translocate. We actually spent most of the time focused on host trees. What do they need? Duty of care. So it was very unusual for the staff to have to go, we're not having a workshop around our potting benches and our potting nicks, and really moving outside of that. And yeah, so it was just another example of whether it's production schedules, connection and finding seeds, or epiphytes and host trees. The workshops this year have been tailored to the needs of the nursery and what they needed to be. And I think that's just probably going to be the ongoing way as well. So if you need it, you know, a nursery that has got something, some knowledge gap or some way they want to play, and we can bring their people together to learn the missing piece of their knowledge, ring me. So that's workshops. This is the outcome of one of the workshops. Devonport restoring... thanks, Jane. Sorry, mind went blank. So they've got a new nursery site. They've got a little nursery site that's probably about not even half this part of the room. And they were moving to another one, which I've fallen in love with. I was openly, acknowledged that in the weekend at our nursery workshop. It's the craziest site you can possibly imagine. It's everything that doesn't tick the box when you say, shall I put a nursery here? It's uphill, it's up steps. It's potting mix, it's up steps, you know, it's like, it's craziness. And it's absolutely stunning, and I love it. So when you've got a difficult site in a new location and you don't want to overwhelm the existing staff, what do? Your workshop, right? Your workshop, and this is one of the outcomes of their workshop. What are all the components that a nursery needs? So it needs water and shade and light. It needs access and mobility. It needs workspace. It needs a swing. I'm a big, big promoter of all nurseries need swings. If you know me, you know this. You need to be able to go and have time out and relax, because it's no good for little baby plants when you're just like, just go and sit on the swing. So we allocated the space in this nursery workshop for the new swing. Where's the water coming from? Where's the power coming from? Where's the tea room? You know, where, how far away is the potting mix coming from to be delivered, and how often? What's that going to cost, and how are you going to plan that? Where are you going to store the seed? You know, there's quite a lot involved in nurseries, right? And getting all of that straight before you start. Not partway in and then go, oh, is anyone any money for some irrigation? Now we've got the trees. Getting all of your basics covered and taking responsibility back on the people that will run the nursery themselves in a way in which empowers them to make a decision. So we don't go into any of the nurseries, new or existing, and say, this is how you should do things. What we do is we go in and we say, what does it take for a volunteer or a staff member to be really well, self-sustaining, happy, socially, you know, able to interact and do all the things they need to do? Because as Derek says, you can grow people and you get plants for that, mm-hmm. right? So if you're going on that method of nursery production, then we look at how the people can work in a nursery site first, what the plants need, and then the group makes a decision. And then we just come in and support to stabilise that. Tāmaki region are looking at several sites to start a new nursery. As I said, several in the Kaipara are starting new nurseries. There's new nurseries popping up existing ones evolving, and some of them are just moving. Some over the fence, and some of them down the road, round the corner, and the craziest sights you've ever seen. But there is a lot of happening in the nursery space. So last weekend we all got together. Well, I wish it was all of us, but it was only a few of us in the end. So, and by the way, the bottom photo is the crazy new nursery. It's just great. It goes up and down and up and back, and it's all covered in weeds. Everyone knows about weeds here, right? There's the weed stock base in this place to last forever. And that's okay if you know at the beginning what you're in for. So whatever you're dreaming up and wanting to set up, make sure you've got a really clear understanding of what you're in for, who your friends are, who can support you, who can get together. And when you go and stick 15 different nursery key personnel into your new nursery space and go, so what do you think? You get an hour of minds, nursery mind hive coming together and saying, wow, this is crazy. No, it's great. It's great. but so they got a lot of solutions out of that. So getting together is really important. We did this 2 years ago, and we couldn't last year, and we got together again. And probably the good things are still good. People wanted to get together, really appreciated being able to share their knowledge, really be able to sit together and see that they're not the only ones, that their challenges are quite similar. Probably the only challenge in there is some of those challenges are just not going away. We haven't solved them yet. We're in for the long haul, even though there's this program here, because there's new and evolving and changing nurseries, the support needed around this space is going to be a long time. Because as I said earlier, biodiversity is still declining. The nursery lists are not expanding yet. The knowledge base of who knows how to grow what is still in notebooks. So one of the things that needs to continue, because we haven't achieved yet, and we're not going to for a while, and that's okay because it's a work in progress, is to actually get the diversity up in nurseries, in this nursery network. As I said earlier, commercial nurseries aren't able to take up the financial burden of trying to grow all of the diversity at the costs and the time frames that it takes to grow some of our trees. Some of those trees take 2 or 3 years. It's not a fast fix, get some harakeke out the door in 9 months. You know, so it's not the role of all commercial nurseries to pick up on what we're doing. It is the role of the iwi hapu community nurseries and backyard nurseries to get together and make sure we're well supported, to be able to get those biodiversity gains, those chocolate species, those, you know, the kereru chocolates that we need, those epiphytes, those other things, those ferns. There's no fern nursery in the whole entire Auckland region. There's a few nurseries growing a few ferns. Like literally, I could put them in this room. The amount of ferns that are being grown for the entire Auckland region, none of them are growing putter that's been grown way up in the far north and been brought back into the region. So we're missing whole types of plants. We're missing whole species. We're missing threatened species. And I see that this network is something that could really be empowered, supported to be able to grow some of those things. Local is good. There's a thing around building kaitiaki or work teams up that work with nurseries, and some of the research says that if you have a work site or program more than 36 minutes from the nursery, the staff don't like it. So that means that if we're having localised nurseries for localised projects, we need X amount of those nurseries to be able to get the coverage, because most of them right now are sitting in the Tāmaki Ecological District. It means all the districts, you know, north, south and around are not well covered yet. So 41 nurseries sounds like a lot, but when more than 50% of them grow less than 5,000 plants, it's not. There's only a handful growing more than 50,000 plants in that network, and none of those grow specialised or or threatened species. So what I haven't actually talked about is nurseries at the botanical gardens, nurseries that are sitting in the regional parks. And they do some amazing work, and actually most of the threatened species work is probably coming out of the botanical gardens, right? But even that is a very small percentage of the area, and it's on a request basis, more than a that's what's being pumped out of there, because financial constraint is a huge thing, even for, of course, the council, right? And so those regional park nurseries are specifically for those parks, and they don't make up the bulk area of the Auckland region. So there's still plenty of work that we need to do. That might be the last one, actually, on that list. Oh, yeah, there you go. So just back, I just wanted to put the map back up. What's the nearest nursery to you? Do you all know? Who here actually volunteers in a nursery or works in a nursery or has a nursery? Yay! Put your hand up if you grow more than 20,000 plants. Yeah. Or more than 5,000? More than 1,000? Yeah. Okay. So still got a lot of work to do. Yeah, still lots of work to do. And I also, as it says there, haven't included the trees for survival program. They're actually the largest producer of plants in the non-profit space. I haven't included them just because the stats around there aren't really clear for the region. They're more national based, but we're aiming to get those. The species lists are quite narrow. They're project and school specific, and they don't have the whole range of the continuity around knowledge and for growing plants other than those few species with those children. There's nothing wrong with that. We need all of our children to do as much work with plants as we can, and so Trees for Survival program is an excellent one. It just needs more work from the rest of us to enrich those current plantings. The only other aspect that I really wanted to let you know about that we need to address is succession planning. Everyone got a succession plan for where they are? Anyone going to put their hand up? Please, someone put their hand up. Okay, that's a bigger issue than I thought. So succession planning in nurseries. When Naito started their nursery last year, it took over 5 months to find a nursery manager. When Orake got their new nursery up in Poriwa, it took over 7 months to find a new nursery manager. When Tiarai switched from their first nursery manager, she had to stay on for another 4 months before they could find a new person who didn't have the same level of knowledge, but they could at least support and upskill into that position, and is very much going that way. Nursery managers, key volunteers, where the knowledge is being held, is a huge issue. You can't grow new nurseries without continuing to grow people. Everyone says the answer is more growing in schools, more school kids coming through, more breaking down the barriers that horticulture isn't just for those people that can't do academic work, you know, smash the myths, you know, break those barriers. But actually, to tell the truth, that's all really important, but we need to find some nursery managers actually right now. So we need people that love plants but are really good at production, planning, supervision, systems, and who want to switch industries. We need to actually target people that are older than 18 to get into those positions. We need to, if you've got Jobs for Nature or whatever system it is for getting more people into this kind of work, we need to focus on beyond just students. They are really important, and we needed them to succession through and career pathway through in the nursery industry. This is a huge industry. This is 41 nurseries. There's no money, but it's still an industry, okay? You know, like, this, I'm just keeping it real. But we really need to start looking at with all the new nurseries coming on board, and nursery managers need a day off. Hey, Derek. You know, like, and who, because in their days off, they go collecting seeds, by the way. So that is also one of the highest risks. Find the seeds, find the people, get people to switch. Kia ora. Is there any questions?